Morning and welcome to the 18th meeting in 2023 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. I remind all members and witnesses to ensure that their devices are on silent and that all other notifications are turned off during the meeting. The first item on our agenda today is to decide whether to take items 3, 4 and 5 in private. Are members agreed?
Agreed.
We're all agreed. Thank you. We now turn to agenda item 2, which is to take evidence from the Scottish Government Bill Team on the Visitor Levy Scotland Bill. And we're joined this morning by Ben Haynes, who's the Bill Manager, Robin Haynes, who's the Head of Council Tax and Alternative Tax Policy, Philip Duffy, who's the Economic Advisor, Ninian Christie, who is a solicitor, and also John Sinclair, who is also a solicitor. And I welcome you all to the meeting. I now invite Ben to make a short opening statement before I open to questions from members. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, convener. And we are very grateful for the opportunity to be here today. We thought it would be helpful to the committee for us to begin with a very brief description of how the provisions in the bill would work in practice if a local authority was seeking to use the discretionary power provided by the bill. Firstly, a local authority would have to publicise an outline of its proposed visitor levy scheme. Section 12 of the bill requires that this outline sets out the objectives for the scheme and an assessment of the impact of the scheme. Scheme's objectives must be related to developing, supporting or sustaining facilities or services which are substantially for or used by those visiting the scheme's area for leisure purposes. In assessing the impact of a visitor levy scheme, the local authority must cover the likely effects of the scheme on those living in the area and anyone else it believes will be affected by the scheme. A local authority must then consult on the scheme. And it has to consult representatives of communities, any businesses in its area that are engaged in tourism, and local tourism organisations. It is also required to consult anyone else it believes would be affected by its proposed scheme. The exact form and manner of that consultation is for the local authority itself to determine. Once the consultation is finished, a local authority is required to publicise a report. This report must summarise the consultation responses received and set out the local authority's decision on whether it is going to proceed with its proposed visitor levy. It must also set out the local authority's reasons for proceeding or not proceeding with introducing a visitor levy. Any visitor levy scheme that is introduced must set out a number of elements. These are in the bill, but include the geographical areas in which the visitor levy would apply, the percentage rate to be applied, the date it would come into force, and the times of year that it would apply. If, after the consultation, a local authority does decide to introduce a visitor levy scheme, it cannot come into force until at least 18 months after its decision. And the reason for that is to give the local authority and accommodation providers time to put in place suitable systems to collect, remit, and enforce a visitor levy. Once a visitor levy scheme has come into force, accommodation providers will need to make returns on the level of visitor levy collected, along with payments of the visitor levy, to the local authority every quarter. Under the bill, these returns and the payments themselves of visitor levy can be made by a third party, such as a booking platform. There are also a number of enforcement powers the local authority can use if necessary, reflecting common practice with other local taxes. Lastly, I should add that two or more local authorities can work together to create a visitor levy that applies in all or parts of both of their areas. So I hope that's helpful to the committee in briefly setting out the process that would have to be followed under the bill, and we're happy to go into any other areas in more detail.
Thanks very much for that. That is very helpful to get that overview of the steps required. I think we'd like to start with a question, which is just why is the legislation required and what's preventing councils from introducing such a tax just now? Is there anything in previous legislation which expressly forbids local authorities from raising their own income? And additionally, on top of that, why did the Scottish Government decide to introduce enabling legislation for potentially 32 local levies rather than introduce a national tourist tax?
Okay, so there's a few elements to that. There are not existing powers that a local authority could use to introduce this measure. Bylaws don't work for this kind of thing, so it has to be an act which would give them the power. It's a piece of enabling legislation because the overriding drive behind it is to fiscally empower local government, give them a new tool to use if they wish to do so in their own areas. There's also the question of competence, and it's very clear that the Scottish Parliament can create local tax to fund local authority expenditure. Robin, I don't know if there's anything you want to add on that.
No, the only other thing I would add to that is our engagement with local authorities suggests it's very clear that there are some parts of the country for which a tourist tax might not be appropriate or considered appropriate, whereas there are other parts of the country and other specific local authorities that have made us aware that they're very keen and see a lot of benefit from being able to apply such a levy and use funds appropriately.
Thanks very much for that. And just to come back on the question around, just clarification around why you chose to introduce potentially 32 local levies rather than just a national tourist tax.
Because the overriding purpose is to give local authorities that tool rather than to create a new national tax. I mean, the bill seeks to put in place an appropriate national framework within which local authorities can induce a visitor levy if, after consultation, they think it's the right thing in their own area.
Great, thanks. So, but giving them that flexibility. I'd also be interested to know, so some local authorities may see the bill as benefiting a select few. I think you've kind of already indicated that some may choose to use it and some not, with no obvious benefits to those councils who decide not to induce the levy. In the Scottish Government's analysis, how many local authorities are likely to introduce and benefit from a local visitor levy, and why should other local authorities and their communities support this legislation?
I think the first thing I would say is under the forthcoming New Deal for local government and the fiscal framework, certainly the Scottish Government is very open to looking at other proposals for other local taxes. It may be this is the first in the queue, so to speak. There are around three or four local authorities that have expressed an interest in introducing a visitor levy and carried out work, potentially to preliminary work to introduce a levy, but clearly we're creating a power in the bill. The bill is seeking to create a power which, if Parliament agrees, will be on the statute book for, you know, potentially decades to come. So although there might not be a large number of local authorities at this point, there may be others in the future. Robin?
I think also, I mean, the bill places certain requirements on what the funds raised can and cannot be used for. And within that, I think it partly answers your question in that we know that there are some local authorities with a high level of tourism in their areas who see the establishment of a tourist levy as a means of raising funds to help better manage and provide better facilities where there are high visitor numbers with a high impact. And there are other local authorities we are aware of who are potentially seeing raising some additional funds through the levy as a means of further promoting their area as a destination and therefore increasing wider local tax take as a consequence of that, and also generally raising standards and facilities in that area.
Yeah, I think that's a good point. The potential is there for more. Just related to that question, one of the things that we're aware of is that you might have high numbers of day trippers, for example, staying in Edinburgh and travelling out, but not staying overnight. And I wonder, could it be the case that such areas continue to shoulder the cost of delivering and maintaining services used by tourists but wouldn't receive any benefit from the legislation? Have you given any thought to that?
You raise a good point, and this was something that was covered in our 2019 consultation. And I think that the legislation is drawn around the levy applying to a particular event of staying overnight in accommodation that is paid for. The corollary of that is what event would happen for day trippers. And initially one might think, well, a tour bus or some visitors might cross a local authority boundary. But the practical impact of that for everyone else would be quite significant. For example, how do you distinguish a visitor from a local? Are there any kind of purposes you might want to exclude from it? So you could end up with a really difficult situation if one was seeking to apply a charge on visitor levies. For example, I would have had to show my council tax bill at the top of the Royal Mile in order to walk down to this building. So I think there was some strong practical implications there as we began to think about this.
Okay, great. I think we're going to get into that in a bit more detail as we go on. I'm now going to bring in Willie Coffey with a couple of questions.
Thanks very much, convener, and good morning to everyone this morning. Ben, you mentioned the New Deal just a moment ago there. I wonder if you could just set out a few more words for us about how the government sees this particular bill in the context of New Deal and perhaps other measures that might come along. The principle of enabling 32 localised solutions, is that something the government sees coming in the future for other parks and other provisions perhaps that might come in as part of the New Deal?
Thank you. I'm slightly constrained in what I can say because I'm aware the New Deal for local government hasn't been signed or published yet. But certainly, I don't think there's any secret that you know, the Scottish Government is keen to provide a new deal for local government to fiscally empower local government to look at a range of levers, open to looking at a range of levers that local authorities could use. Potentially, the visitor levy is the first in a series of measures. It's the one that the most policy development has been carried out and a formal consultation. But certainly, I think the new deal will include is like to include discussions around a process by which local government and Scottish Government could talk about potential future levies, potential new taxes that could be introduced. And certainly the thrust of that is to allow local authorities the flexibility to come up with solutions and tools that work in their area.
Thank you very much for that very careful response. I wonder if I could maybe just ask a question on the response from the tourism sector. It's not been exactly positive, has it, really, to the proposal, and quite a number of the comments that are coming in are basically about adding to business costs and so on and so forth. I wonder if you could offer some reflections and views on that, please.
Yeah, I mean, I'd say it's probably been a mixed bag, and certainly I think we've listened quite hard to the points that have been raised by industry. Certainly they were very much seeking to have the funding circumscribed in some way for certain purposes. I think the bill takes that into account. There's also a lot of consultation that's required before a visitor levy is introduced and the requirement for impact, assessments of the impact to be carried out. So we have listened and responded to the views of business on that. I think it is a bit more nuanced than it sometimes comes across from the tourism organisations. I think there are a range of views from the tourism industry out there. Some I'm not so keen on it, others are. We've always been clear that it will have a cost impact on local on businesses, tourism businesses, accommodation providers. If a visitor levy is introduced, we've sought to minimise that in every way that we can, and it's something we would very much expect local authorities to take into account. Philip, do you want to add anything on the work around business costs?
Yeah. As part of the exercise, we consulted with a number of businesses around these compliance challenges, potentially with a visitor levy, and those were reflected in the business and regulatory impact assessment. So we have captured, I think, and recognised that there are implementation and costs and some ongoing costs to that collection process. But as Ben, as you said, the aim of that consultation period is to minimise those where possible. Mm-hmm.
And if the bill does proceed and come in, will the government look at that impact, that cost impact that businesses are concerned about at some future point if we review the effectiveness of the policy and the scheme?
I think we'd be open to doing that, but I'm also very aware that these would be local authority schemes, and there is a sort of three-yearly review built into the bill itself. So I think we would want to tread a little bit carefully in terms of not looking over the shoulder of local authorities when they're making these decisions.
I think it's also worth highlighting that Mr. Arthur, as lead minister for this bill, on the day it was published, wrote to Visit Scotland, Scottish Tourism Alliance and COSLA, inviting them to form an expert group tasked very specifically with looking at guidance and best practice for local authorities wishing to use the discretionary power the bill seeks to create. And we very much see and very much imagine that being the forum for ensuring that a local authority, using some of the compliance measures that are set out and the collection measures and the set out in the bill, approaches that with their eyes wide open and a thorough understanding of how that can be, those burdens can be minimised. And I also think that expert group provides a forum for ensuring there's an understanding amongst local authorities that the burden will be different for different sorts of accommodation providers. I mean, the business regulatory impact assessment already distinguishes between different sizes of business, and you can imagine perhaps, so for a micro business whose booking sheet is a calendar by the phone sort of thing, there might be the compliance might look like drawing another column on that, whereas for other accommodation providers using accommodation management systems, the functionality already exists because these systems are sold overseas. So there's a range of things which I think is beneath the provisions of the bill, which it would be really essential for local authorities and business to get together and understand and identify how they might be best implemented.
Okay, thank you very much for that. I hope to come back in later on if I may. Thank you, convener.
Yeah, thanks, Willie. Yeah, it was good to get that detail about the extra column on the balance book, because that's something that has come up to me being a Highlands and Islands MSP with quite a lot of people that provide accommodation. Miles, you wanted to come in with questions.
Thank you, convener. Good morning. Thank you for joining us today. I wanted to ask a couple of detailed questions. The first was in relation to where funding currently is being allocated. And at the moment, council tax and non-domestic rates are taken into account when general funding allocations by the Scottish Government are decided. As an Edinburgh MSP, we receive one of the lowest levels of funding per head of population, which the committee are aware of as I raise it every meeting. But I just wondered, in terms of the legislation being proposed, whether or not this will be considered in future calculations for the general revenue grant allocation, and whether or not there's discussions going on in government about that.
No, the intention is it's not taken into account when deciding on those.
And that's in part why the provisions of the bill say the receipts raised from a local authority applying this levy should be, it's a delicate term in local government finance, but effectively ring-fenced. And separately segregated and accounted for separately, so they will be not part of the wider local government funding arrangements.
Allocation. Yeah. Thank you. Thanks for that. As we've heard already, I think the tourism sector, especially here in Edinburgh, given the significance it is to our economy, the Edinburgh Festival especially, and what that might mean. Now, I know the Scottish Government have had a number of concerns put to them around the fact that VAT is applied to accommodation in the UK and is amongst the highest in Europe. The majority of EU companies operating tourist tax have notably lower rates of VAT on accommodation than the UK. So I just wondered how you'd responded to those concerns from the sector as well.
I mean, I would say general taxation is a very complicated picture.
Sure.
The VAT regime varies quite a lot. Philip, do you want to just pick up on some of the examples, I think, quite helpful.
Yeah, it's true that Scotland and the UK, 20% VAT rate is one of the highest in Europe, but obviously this is one of a number of basket of taxes that are sort of paid by the industry. Everything we I guess, point out is that in other comparative countries, the point at which the turnover threshold for paying VAT is much lower. So I think in Spain, for example, there's no registration threshold, so you'll be paying, even the smallest businesses will be paying VAT, whereas that's not the case here. Those kind of comparisons, it's very hard to make generalizations. I mean, you can pick at one particular business and compare it between countries, but to make a generalization is very difficult. But we do recognize that VAT is higher in Scotland than other countries.
VAT captures everybody on the chain, whereas this only can.
Do you want to come in, John, as well?
No, if I may come in. The Breer also highlights research by others that recognises that tourism in the UK as a whole is not, in price terms alone, especially competitive. But when the wider visitor offer is considered, it suddenly becomes a very attractive destination and is very high in the rankings. And I also it may sound like a flippant aside, for which I ask you to forgive me, but I do remember from my earlier economics lectures that, as an undergraduate, that price is the lowest form of competition as well. And that is reflected in that research that says the UK as a visitor destination's competitiveness comes from the whole offer rather than just purely price.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think the main concern was around that, what percentage this would then add and where that comes in, given councils will have that flexibility up to 100%, which I think would then potentially make us uncompetitive, depending where the councils decide to put that level. Now, the consultation, which has a few of you have mentioned already, was conducted, I believe, in 2019, before the pandemic and cost of living crisis. So just wondered what further consultation the Scottish Government intend to undertake. I know the Scottish Tourism Alliance have called for the committee to undertake some work on that, but just wondered, given we are operating a very different climate now post-pandemic, whether or not the Scottish Government have revisited that consultation or intend to.
So, since the bill was obviously work on visitor levy was paused in spring 2020 for obvious reasons. Since it came out of the deep freeze, as it were, we've had a series of engagements with stakeholders. Ministers have obviously been meeting relevant parties as well. In terms of specifically looking at the business, we went back to the businesses where we had conducted face-to-face interviews with a follow-up survey to see what had changed since they completed that. And I just would slightly question that we're in a very different world now. Certainly in terms of the tourism industry, it's bounced back very strongly and is now close to kind of pre-pandemic levels. Philippa, I don't know if you've got the relevant figures there.
The terms of our kind of inbound international visitors, we're seeing a strong recovery, still slightly behind where we were in 2019 in terms of overall numbers, although the spend seems to be up. Still waiting for the picture for domestic visitors, that those statistics are still to be compiled, but the early indication is there is a recovery to where we were pre-pandemic.
There are certainly challenges, but it does seem to be in a pretty robust position.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks for that, and hopefully, if we've got time, could come up in later on some other points. Thanks.
Okay. Camilla. Thanks, Miles. Annie.
Thanks, convener. Good morning. In 2018, COSLA called for a tax on visitors and not on businesses. Given that the liable person on the bill is the owner of the premises, can the government say that this is not a tax on business?
So, just on the technical aspect, I think Robin's keen to come in. I mean, the first thing I think I would say is the bill is constructed in a way where the accommodation provider is the person who has to collect and remit the tax, and liability focuses on them. Primarily, that's a question about enforcement. If a local authority is, it's much more realistic to If it has to take enforcement action to take that against, say, you know, a hotel in Edinburgh, than it is an American tourist who owes £8 and has disappeared back to the USA. So I would just say that on the technical side. Robin, I think you look like you're...
No, I was just going to endorse that exact point, Leslie, that and I suppose you could say it's a bit analogous to a retailer charging VAT, mm-hmm. in that... If you or I were to buy a product on which VAT is charged, that's not a tax on business. We have to pay for it. But it's the compliance burden, and we recognise that, and we've already talked about it in committee this morning, does indeed fall upon the business, but mm-hmm. the person that pays it will be the one consuming the product.
Cool. And just another question from me. In the Bill's Business and Regulatory Impact Assessment and Policy Memorandum, it discusses a range of other options which could be considered, for example, the Manchester Business Improvement District and the Slovenia example. And I was just wondering whether you could describe the various other options that were considered and why the government chose to pursue this tax.
I'll just touch on the bid. So one of the objectives of the bill is around fiscally empowering local authorities. BID doesn't do that. I mean, they have useful purposes and, mm-hmm. and they have their place, but it doesn't really do that, because effectively the BID is very much controlled by the businesses that are involved in it. The local authority collects that money, doesn't control how that money is used, mm-hmm. is involved in that decision making. So it doesn't really meet that aspect. You know, though I know there are BIDs in other places. In terms of the Slovenia example, I think I'll hand across to Philip, who I know has had a look at this.
Yeah, the tax in Slovenia, it is, it functions much like the taxes in other parts of Europe, where most of the tax is raised in the city and used to within the city budget. But there is an additional supplement which raises funds to... for their equivalent, like, visitor agency, although my understanding is they still are mainly funded by a block grant are centrally funded by the government, but there's a sort of top-up. So it works very similar to I guess, the visitor levy that's being proposed here, but the way the funding is used for that is sort of slightly different, being that part of it is used to fund their kind of... National Visitor Agency.
Thank you. Thanks, Convener. Thanks.
Danny and Marie wanted to come in.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. The percentage rate would be different for councils themselves to decide, and the bill places no restrictions on this rate, that would it be. Has the Scottish Government done modelling of the behavioural impact of different percentage rates, and at what point might the rate start to become a deterrent?
I think I will hand across to Philip on that, because we have carried out quite a lot of work on that aspect.
So, we have looked into, you know, potentially what the revenues could be raised from different rates of the visitor levy, ranging from 1% to 7%, and that's in the, if we see that in the BREA. Yes, we have looked at what evidence there are for behavioural effects on price increases. I think the first thing I would say is there's very limited Scotland-specific evidence of how visitors might kind of respond to price increases. In the literature, you can find a range of estimates around the price sensitivity, but there's a lot of context-specific factors. So a lot of the literature will say kind of beach resort destination in the Mediterranean, where they're easily substitutable, if this price differentiation between those venues, those destinations, visitors might be more price sensitive. Where there's a location that's kind of more unique, where there isn't somewhere that's substitutable, that's perhaps less of a factor. The other thing we've looked at is just in practical terms, for cities in Europe that have introduced these taxes recently, they haven't seen generally a negative impact on visitor demand, with the numbers of overnight visits increasing in the years after these taxes have been introduced. The question of the interaction between what that rate is and the potential negative impacts on visitor behaviour would have to be kind of considered by each local authority as they assess the impact of the measures that they're considering.
Anyone else?
I think I would just echo Robin's point earlier of, there are many things that attract people to come and visit Scotland and UK more widely. Cost is probably not up there as one of the top factors. And I think that plays into this point as well.
I think it also would point out it plays into the Scottish Government's wider tourism strategy going forward. We have many unique offerings. People come to play golf at St Andrews. People come to go and see Edinburgh Castle. People come to go and put their toe in the fairy pools in the sky or try and spot the Loch Ness Monster. And none of those are substitutable experiences for which there are alternatives elsewhere.
Thank you. Just on the subject of percentages again, the bill would also permit the percentage rate to be different from different purposes or different areas within the local authority area, but not for different types of accommodation. Can you outline some of the different purposes that councils might apply different rates for and why? I'll just pop it out to whoever can answer.
Yeah, so I think probably the easiest example is fringe performers. Edinburgh fringe performers, local authority Edinburgh might want to create a lower rate for themselves. Certainly I know some local authorities have expressed in the past when they have particular events, such as COP26, they would like the ability to be able to increase rates for purpose accommodation booked for those purposes. There's a large degree of flexibility for local authorities in within the bill. They can certainly make all sorts of adaptations and flexibilities that work for their particular circumstances. I think you've touched on one that they don't have under the bill, which is a different percentage rate for different accommodation types. I think it was just felt that was given all the other flexibilities that a local authority has, that was perhaps introducing a degree of complexity that wasn't necessary. I think would be the feeling there's enough other tools to make adaptations without having to go down that route.
Thanks for that.
Sorry, also, I think if you look at geographies, perhaps offering two examples. One might be the city of Edinburgh itself, comparing the, for example, the old town with the wider city. There might be a justification there. And contrasting that with a very large local authority like Highland, which has a great diversity of visitor attractions within it and degree of attractiveness within it. And the bill as drafted would give such a council an opportunity to manage and apply the levy as it saw fit within that very wide and diverse geography.
Thank you.
Yeah, I think the different, in other countries that have different rates for different types of accommodation, those are usually where there's a flat rate. And it reflects the kind of quality of the accommodation, and in effect, having a percentage rate because these different quality of accommodation will obviously vary by price. The tax burden will vary without needing to set different rates for different types of accommodation.
Thanks for that. Appreciate your responses.
Thanks, Marie. Just on the back of that, and Robin, you may have covered this in your response, but I'd just be interested to hear. So if a council decides to apply a levy in part of its area but not in others, would there be a case for any revenue raised being spent in that same geographical area where the levy was raised?
There could be. We're not prescriptive about that in the bill as drafted. And I think as a common theme to some of the things we've discussed has been this is very much about giving local authorities power and discretion. One could imagine if a revenue is to apply at a particular rate in a very small geography, it might be a bit questionable as to whether the ultimate sums raised were going to make a difference to that area. But I think the key point is it's for local authorities to determine. We're not prescriptive about that.
Right, yeah. So it's something that they might draw out in a consultation. Yeah, great. Ivan, you wanted to come in.
Yeah. Thanks very much, convener. Good morning. We talked about this proposal and the bill in the context of the New Deal for local government, but of course there's also a New Deal for business as well, running alongside that in business. And you've mentioned the STA and others have got quite a lot of input that they've made into the proposals. I think the first I just wanted to explore a wee bit more was round about, and you've kind of mentioned this already, I don't want to use that word, but the ring fencing of the funds for specific uses, and clearly STA and others very keen that it seemed to be directly used to support and benefit the visitor economy. So I maybe just want to unpick and explore a wee bit what the proposals are in that regard and what the options might be.
Yeah, certainly. So I think the bill tries to chart a middle way, or does chart a middle way. You know, there are some stakeholders who would very much like the money to be funneled into very specific tourism projects with ideally very little involvement from local authorities. There are other stakeholders who make an argument that this should just become for general local authority expenditure. Visitors have an impact on all sorts of services. It should be shouldn't be any restrictions on it whatsoever. And I think the bill takes a kind of middle way of meaning this money has to be separately accounted for, it's transparent, it has to be set objectives for what the scheme will do, and has to be reported on every year, and creates a sort of boundary around the use of that funding, which, as I've mentioned, is developing, supporting and sustaining facilities and services which are substantially for or used by people visiting the area where the visitor levy applies. And we feel that strikes the right balance between making sure that this money, which is raised from visitors, goes towards things that visitors use or that are for visitors, without being overly prescriptive about exactly what that funding can be used for.
Right. Is there any examples you can give of the kind of things that may or may not be included in that definition? Which sounds a great definition, but I suppose the devil's in the detail, and you get down to trying to figure out what exactly may or may not be included.
Some examples that might be facilities where they currently don't exist in rural areas to accommodate visitors, whether that be, I mean, there already is one there, but car parks around attractions like the fairy pools might be one example. Another very different example might be using funds to better promote a particular destination. And I think in both of those, the common strand is ultimately, if a meaningful sum of money is raised and both of those things are done right, then it actually enhances the attractiveness of that area to visitors, and therefore potentially is of benefit to tourism and hospitality businesses in that area.
Absolutely, and also to increasing revenue by more visitors coming for the local authority and others as a consequence of that as well. Is there any thought been given to the proposals from the STA about the mechanism for deciding what money is spent on? Because I think they were talking about a local group in each authority that had the tax in place to make the decisions, or at least oversee what the money was getting spent on between local authority and others, business, etc., being involved in that.
I don't think we would probably want to define structures within the bill that have to be followed, but as Robin has mentioned, that we are creating an expert group. Ministers have invited STA and COSLA to sit on that, which will be developing guidance and best practice. I think we would anticipate that that guidance and best practice would talk about the mechanisms that a local authority could put in place to decide on how that funding is used.
Okay, so it's on the agenda, but not being prescriptive. Okay.
And fundamentally, I think the important point to emphasise in that is that local authorities are, or councils rather, are democratically elected entities accountable to their electorate.
Yeah.
And so if the decision is made within that council, supported by the provisions in the bill and the best practice that this expert group is tasked with developing, then one could argue that that's a good thing for all.
Okay. Okay. And just go back to something you said earlier, if I understood you correctly. What you said was the fact that the funds are ring-fenced is actually, to some extent, an advantage for local authorities because it means that money isn't washed into the general calculation round about the block grant. So there are actually advantages to local authorities as well as to tourism businesses for that money being ring-fenced to some extent.
Very much so. I suppose the corollary of what you've just described would be if revenues raised were to be part of general local authority funding, it would be fundamentally unfair that, for example, schooling in Edinburgh potentially could be better funded simply because there's a castle on a volcanic rock in the middle of the city compared to other parts of the country that don't have that attribute.
Okay, great. And so then last question. Clearly, one of the key issues with regards to the relationship with business and regulation in general is cumulative impact. So I don't know if there's, or you can let us know if there's been any consideration as to how this proposal would interact with everything else that's impacting business or has been proposed for business, and what the mechanism is for assessing all of those different regulatory proposals that are in play at the moment.
Certainly our colleagues who lead on New Deal for Business, we're quite engaged with them. They have that wider overview. So certainly they're aware of this work. Some of the same people are involved in the New Deal for Business as are familiar with the visitor levy. I think it would be, you know, those wider bodies around New Deal for Business that would look at cumulative impact. Certainly, we play our part in making sure that they're aware of the work that we're undertaking.
Sure, but that works in both directions because they could come back and say, you know what, there's six other things set in business as well. Therefore, you need to have another look at this. So that's considered. Okay. Thank you.
And Willie, you wanted a supplementary on that?
Thanks, Convener. It's on that point that Ivan raised about the purpose to which the levy can be put and who decides. Let me give you an example. Say Edinburgh City wanted to improve that wee section of the cobblestone road at the top of the Royal Mail, which is like driving on the moon. I'm sure that would be welcomed by everybody, tourists and locals alike. Supposing Edinburgh decided to repair that and use the visitor levy money for that, would that be okay? Do they have to get permission to do that from the government, or to whom do they account for having done that?
So
tourists can use that section of the road just as much as we can. Yeah. What would be the view of that, Ben, do you think?
There's no requirement for a local authority to get permission from Scottish Government on what it uses the funding for. Mm-hmm. It has to obviously abide by the provisions in the bill. That there may well be a case for that. I'm certainly familiar with things like the North Coast 500, which has an impact on roads in that area. I think that would be something a local authority would have to consult on and as include as part of its scheme. But it would be potentially something that was a facility that was used and service that was used by visitors. And so that those kind of things could potentially be funded. Robin, I don't know if you want to add.
I don't know. I think the obverse of that would be much plainer, in that there would be many streets within the capital which are far removed from the tourist landscape, and I think it would be wholly legitimate to contest the use of any visitor levy in the maintenance of such streets.
But the Royal Mail might be an exception to that.
You could imagine the case being made, but again, I wouldn't wish to prejudge such.
Okay, I thought I'd probe
such decisions.
Thanks very much for your answers on that. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Willie. I actually have a follow-on, which I totally take the point that it's to the local authority to run a consultation on their design of this. But just on the north, you mentioned the North Coast 500, and I wonder about hospitality issues in Highland, for example. And so in your work in developing the bill, did you come across any thinking around maybe using some of the money for training people into the hospitality sector, which I think is much needed at the moment?
I don't recall that coming up in the consultation. I'm just looking at my colleagues. I think there could be a case made for that under the bill. It's not something that's been raised with us directly that I recall.
Okay, but something that a local authority could look into in their consultation.
Yeah, certainly they could look into it in the consultation.
Great, thanks very much. Mark, you wanted to come in.
Yep, thanks, Kavina. I wanted to touch on the issue of cruise ship stays and that these have been omitted from the bill, although I know that government are considering that as further discussions part of the New Deal. I just wanted to ask why specifically cruise ship stays have been omitted, given that COSLA called for it and, you know, they're commonplace in other European cities.
Shall I?
Duke's right, well, I'll start. I think it's a very different animal from a hotel that is fixed in one local authority area and people are booking overnight accommodation. Obviously, cruise ships are movable assets, go to a variety of places, and somebody who is going on a cruise ship, they are staying on the cruise ship, but they're also paying for being moved around to different places and visiting different locations. So the taxable event is very different, and I think the powers and the provisions that you would need around that would be very different than the ones that we have in the bill. Robin?
You made reference to this being considered in other fora and potentially under the New Deal for local government. There will be a fiscal framework for local government which will include measures about how an alternative new local tax might be assessed, and we see this potentially being a candidate. And to kind of expand on what Ben was saying about how this is a different thing, the taxable event is different. It's not as if we said, no, we're not doing that. We did engage with stakeholders and realised that it's not a reason for not doing it, but there are many questions which would need to be addressed and understood. So, for example, how should crew be treated if they come on shore? What would the taxable event be? Would it be disembarkation by passengers? Would it be the port authority that is responsible for collecting it, or would it be the cruise ship operator? What about when cruise ships are moored offshore and passengers are tendered onshore? How would the levy work? So, just in introducing those, I hope I'm demonstrating that it's not as if we've said, no, we're not doing that, just as a blanket no. It's just more a realisation there's a lot to that, a lot that needs to be understood. And because it is a different taxable event, we see it as being a separate exercise to the one that is before the committee today.
I can see the attraction in it because, you know, there are clearly some local authorities that would benefit to a much greater extent using a cruise ship levy than they ever will for an overnight stay on land. I mean, Barcelona have answered these questions. I appreciate these are different questions that you're talking about, but other areas have answered them. Have there been any work with other areas who have introduced a similar levy? Like I say, there are areas of the country who would benefit massively from it.
I think the best answer I can give to that is I've indicated that we have given this some consideration, but unfortunately, one thing at a time. I think, given the resources available, as I said, I think this is has strong potential to be possibly one of the earlier candidates for consideration under the fiscal framework arrangements for local government that I described, but to have included them in this bill would probably have delayed the bill and required a whole separate consultation exercise by several years, potentially. Not because it's all too difficult and all the rest of it, just because this is a tax and there are reputational concerns for this Parliament and the Scottish Government for protecting their integrity as a taxing jurisdiction. So we would want to ensure, as officials, we'd be advising ministers to ensure that everything that they did as correctly as possible in taking that legislation forward.
Okay, thanks. Mr. St Clair, was it right in hearing from the Cymru that you are causeless, solicitor?
No.
Not sorry. Well, I misheard that at the start. So I was going to see if there was a view from causal. That's fine. My second question, and convener, declare an interest as a convener of the cross-party group on carers, was around exemptions. Now, within the bill, there is the ability for local authorities to provide exemptions, but also for national exemptions. And I wonder why it wasn't considered appropriate to include an exemption at the outset for people travelling for hospital care or people travelling to provide care. I'm thinking particularly about parents who will be staying in hotels to be close to sick kids in hospitals, and why it wasn't appropriate to include that on the face of the bill.
I think on the general question around exemptions, the bill is quite carefully constructed to avoid various groups of people falling into the visitor levy. So anybody who is using overnight accommodation as their main or usual place of residence won't be liable for the levy, which obviously deals with people who are homeless or perhaps fleeing domestic abuse or refugees in the widest layperson's sense of that term. Exemptions are something that we expect the expert group to pick up and to produce guidance for local authorities on. We are quite aware that it will vary a lot. There'll be some local authorities where people travelling for medical treatment, you know, that may be a valid consideration. There'll be other local authorities where that isn't something that has to be taken into account. So we took the decision that it was best, ministers took the decision it was best for that not to be on the face of the bill, but to be something that can be picked up in guidance with the backstop of regulations, if necessary, depending on how things turn out with the guidance and what practice looks like in different local authorities. Robin, do you want to...
No, I think also part of that thinking was under that common heading of exemptions, there are things that... would be of very specific concern to all carers and support for medical treatment being an example, but there would be other exemptions that are very specific to that local authority area. I think Ben already mentioned we have received representations in the past about exempting fringe performers for Edinburgh, for example, which is a completely different circumstance to the one you've described, but nevertheless it comes under the heading of exemptions, which is why certainly informed ministers' views as to why this is something which we felt was more appropriately dealt with at the local level.
Okay, thank you.
Mark, we've got a little bit of time in hand, so Miles has some other questions.
I think the exemptions question is quite an important one, and you know, deciding to exempt cruise ships from the legislation, but then I think the detail of allowing councils then to decide of this is something we need to pursue. So, you know, for example, people who live in Edinburgh having family members coming to stay to see whether or not their council tax would allow them to then be exempt. Has that been looked at in any way of friends and family members coming? They might be providing a caring situation as well. I'm just wondering whether or not that had been looked at. And I think you said earlier, Mr. Hayes, that you hadn't necessarily looked at a definition of a tourist for the bill, did I hear that right? And what then, that will lead to quite a lot of definitions being needed for any exemptions, I think.
A couple of points on that. I don't think we did touch on that, but yes, we haven't defined tourist in the bill. I think both of your questions really point towards that the practicalities of an exemption, of running an exemption, how that might work, could really be quite complicated. And we're very aware that it will be local authorities who will be administering these schemes, working with overnight accommodation providers in their area. The bill makes some provision around that, such as around exemption vouchers, but ministers really felt that it was important that those who are going to be involved in administering this, so local authorities and overnight accommodation providers, discussed in detail how exemptions might work at a practical level, which will inform what exemptions are put in place. Because we are aware, and the evidence shows, that the more complicated you make a scheme, the more expensive it is to administer and the more difficult it is to administer. So I think your question points towards the kind of slightly complex practical implications that you can get into with exemptions, and that's why we really felt it was something that was best addressed by the industry and local government discussing together what might work at a practical level.
But there's nothing in the bill then which would prevent a council wanting, if they did, like Edinburgh, to say, well, if you have a family member coming to stay, that can be an exemption. If you book it yourself, for example, and the booking system could, say, include that.
I don't think there's anything. I'm looking at my lawyers, but I don't think there's anything in the bill that would prevent a local authority from doing that.
Yep. I'm sure a lot of Edinburgh residents will be keen on that to be included. But is there also, to go back to what you said earlier, it's a sad situation that a lot of hotels and guest houses are currently being used in Edinburgh for temporary accommodation or emergency accommodation. That is then included in terms of not being captured under this tax. Am I right in saying that? And I think you touched upon the Ukrainian refugee situation and also people fleeing domestic abuse who might, as an emergency, be housed in hotels or guest houses.
Yes, that's right, in that if somebody is using overnight accommodation as their place of residence or you know, their main or usual place of residence, then they're not liable for the levy. We felt that was constructing it in that way was the best way of avoiding those sort of groups that you've referred to.
And would that include, I'm just wondering what the legal definition though is, because I know from casework people often are moving around different hotels or guest houses depending on the availability, especially during the festival when hotels basically kind of want to empty the hotels purely for tourism use. And so I wasn't sure if there's a legal definition of what that then would be, your main emergency accommodation.
Yeah. And John, do you want to pick up that?
We think the expression usual residence is quite well understood. Mm-hmm. There's probably also an implication, no more than an implication in the bill read as a whole, that it will be commercial transactions that will be taxed rather than non-commercial. And most of the ones that Ben has mentioned as candidates for exemptions would not come under the commercial heading, like housing Ukrainians or something.
Okay, and you'd imagine the council in that case would very much want to have that defined.
Yes.
Before they take any of this forward, given their responsibilities. And just finally, I know this has been touched upon earlier, for different periods, you know, obviously the Edinburgh Festival is a very one-off, but for some parts, I used to work in the tourism industry in Perthshire, for example, that is very seasonal. Do you expect, or is it just in terms of exemptions and flexibility for winter months, for example, for this tax not necessary to then be applied to make sure that the Highlands, for example, are not discouraging people in quiet periods?
I mean, there's a couple of points there. I mean, obviously, it's a percentage rate, so naturally the level of visitor levy falls when accommodation costs less. And yes, there's provisions in the bill to allow a visitor levy scheme to only apply between certain dates, and that can be fairly broad as well in terms of, you know, running from Easter to the last Sunday in September. So it doesn't have to be just specific dates. It can also be times of the year.
Yeah, that's helpful. Thank you. Thanks.
Sorry, just returning to your previous question, I think Section 4, Paragraph 1, is the bit that captures the... It will apply where it's not somebody's usual place of residence. So by definition, if someone doesn't have another usual place of residence, then they would be, by definition, beyond the scope of the bill.
That's helpful. Thank you. Thanks.
Okay, thanks very much for that. I just wanted to pick up on something that you may have said it in your opening remarks, but you mentioned it when you were talking to Ivan, that local authorities, that the system would be reported on every year. Is that reported to the Scottish Government?
No, in line with the SIPFA accountancy rules, the local authority has to publish the amount of money that's been collected, the amount of money that's been used for administration every year, and and the performance of the scheme by reference to its objectives. So it has to do that every year.
Okay, that's great. It sounds actually also very straightforward, because that's one of the other things that's been coming up for us in the conversations around the New Deal, is the onerous reporting that local authorities often end up having to do with national schemes. So that sounds pretty straightforward. I just wanted to check on it. So thanks so much for coming in this morning. I think that's been really helpful. We got all our burning questions answered, and I think a lot more clarity on the bill. So I really appreciate that. And as we agreed that at the start of the meeting today to take the next items in private, that's the last public item for today, and I now close the public part of the meeting. Thank you.